I am going to have to ask you not to clap, because I've learned from my progressive friends that clapping can be triggering. And if you attend, like at Occupy Wall Street, for example, if there was someone speaking, instead of clapping, which can even cause panic attacks in speakers and attendees, if you would just use jazz hands, if you like, or give me a big round of, you know, clicking your fingers. That's it. Thank you. And I hope YAF adopts that as a policy because of it. It's wonderful to be here, and I'm just not accustomed to such friendly-looking crowds. And no posters and protesters and no Antifa. Did Antifa show up? No. Well, my topic today is... Oh, I want to put on my timer so I don't keep... Ooh, what did I do? Cancel. Just start. Okay. My topic today is how to survive the wacky gender politics on campus. However, it's not only on campus now. The wackiness has moved into the society at large. So my topic is how to survive the wacky gender politics that surrounds us today everywhere. Now, please listen carefully. I know there are some out there who are thinking, I don't think I really care about gender politics. Well, let me tell you something. It cares about you. And if we don't find a way to contain it, there's so much is at stake. I mean, it's already threatening the integrity of our institutions of higher learning. I see this divisive politics, this politics of anger and recrimination moving into, certainly in journalism, it's in Silicon Valley, it's in Hollywood, and it's not solving problems. It's creating confusion, chaos, and tribalism. Now, you could call it a sort of safe space, trigger warning, privilege checking, victim obsessed style of feminism. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about where it came from, and especially the students. Where are most of the high school students sitting? You're there, there. Oh, okay, I'm there. All right. So a lot of this is for you because this is a battle. I'm leaving to you. I've been fighting it for 25 years, and I haven't yet won. I thought I did for a while, and then about 3 years ago, it erupted all over again. And by the way, before I even start with telling you what's going on, let me just say a word about my background and my identity. I am, a heteronormative, cisgendered, Jewish, age-enhanced, female... a female-identified person with a gender non-conforming maltipoo named Izzy. And I'm checking her DNA because I think she is non-conforming. She's so aggressive. I'm thinking there's 1.0024 pit bull in there, something. But anyway, way back in the last century, I was a feminist academic in good standing. I was invited to read papers at women's conferences, and some of my academic articles were included in feminist anthologies. All of that changed around 1994 when I published a book called Who Stole Feminism? Because I had noticed that feminist theory, particularly in my field of philosophy, was ridiculously radical and denigrating of classical liberal tradition that I believed in. It was so outside the norm that I just thought, gee, this is odd. I'm going to write a paper about it and go to the American Philosophical Association and tell everybody about it and critique it, and that'll be, you know, problem solved. I did go to the American Philosophical Association to read a paper about it, and I did it for the Society of Women in Philosophy, and it was a room like this. And while I was speaking, this never happened before, to my knowledge, at the American Philosophical Association. Usually you go there, you read a paper, and then people criticize you. It's not altogether pleasant, but then you go out for drinks. We did not go out for drinks. While I was speaking, women were hissing and stamping their feet. And I realized, and I was excommunicated from a religion I did not know existed. Now, in my book, Who Stole Feminism, it was strongly feminist in the sense that I do believe in the equality of the sexes and equal opportunity, liberty, dignity. I call it equality of opportunity feminism, or equity feminism for short. And I just found it absurd, even by the 80s and 90s, to call American society patriarchal and oppressive. It seemed to have no basis in reality. So I, you know, and this equity feminism that I believe in, it developed out of the European Enlightenment and had, you know, through the 19th century and 20th century, has transformed the lives of women throughout the world, but especially in the United States. But equity feminism, the feminism that liberated women, that got us the vote and got us so many other liberties and equality of for education, that has never been the style favored on campus, especially among feminist theorists. For reasons I still do not understand, they are attracted to a theory that views society as a pervasive, all-encompassing, women-devouring, male supremacist hegemony, male hegemony. And there were writers in the 70s and 80s, they're still around. Well, they're still around. That's like Catherine MacKinnon, but and Andrea Dworkin. I'll sum up their worldview. This was from Andrea Dworkin. She said, under patriarchy, every woman's daughter is a victim. Under patriarchy, every woman's son is her potential betrayer and also the inevitable rapist or exploiter of another woman. Everyone? I mean, what is she talking about? Now, I will tell you, there a group of libertarian feminists rose up and challenged them in the early 90s. We had a big battle, and there were feminists like me that associated the women's movement with liberation. You know, so we were the equals to men, not so we could be protected from these vile patriarchal oppressors. And it wasn't just me. There were women. There was Camille Paglia. There was Katie Royfe. There were journalists like Kathy Young and Wendy Kaminer, Nadine Strossen, who was president of the ACLU at the time. Wendy Kaminer in the ACLU. And actually, we won the argument against their kooky theories. We won the argument, and at that time, the New York Times was on our side, and the New York Magazine ran a big article about Camille Paglia and the resistance to Catherine MacKinnon and Andrea Dworkin and the conspiracy theorists about patriarchy. We won the argument, but they quietly assumed all the assistant professorships. They and their like-minded sisters just kept building on this theory. For them, women in our society are in a subordinate class, and every institution bears the impress of patriarchy. Every institution must be interrogated, and you have to discover the hidden power dynamics that keep women down, and innocent things that conventional marriage or romance, the fashion industry, the beauty industry, these are all part of this compromised and dangerous system, as well as, you know, things like catcalling, harassment, pornography, sexual assault. For them, it's all on a continuum, or it's all part of a machine to keep women in their place. I have just never been able to see it that way. It seems to me to be, as I said before, a sort of conspiracy theory. And if you try to fault it, they will just tell you that you're part of the problem we're trying to solve. You become an agent of the master narrative. This has been going on for years. Now, recently, and this is what the students are going to encounter when they get to college, it's melded with a theory called intersectionality. What, there are respectable forms of intersectionality, but I'm talking about the one that's gained dominance in, you know, among activists on the campus. And it's the idea that now it's not just that you're oppressed as a woman, but we have to take all oppression categories together. And some people have multiple oppressions, so they are multiply marginalized. And there's a complicated hierarchy of privilege, that's white, able-bodied males, and then everybody else. And then you want to get, you know, you have a certain number of oppression points, depend, and there are these proliferating isms. Let me explain this, because I saw it in action years ago. All these ideas were there years ago, and they remained there and got stronger. They never went away. And one reason I think they didn't go away is, who wants to challenge them? Because if you're a man and you do it, it's risky. You'll be accused of, in fact, they brought up, they called it intellectual harassment. And for a woman to do it, you're called, I was called names, a traitor to my gender, anti-woman. He was even called a non-woman once. Someone referred to Christina Hoff Sommers and Margaret Thatcher as those two female impersonators. Someone called me that recently on Twitter, and then someone on social media called them out for using the, apparently you're not supposed to use the word female impersonator, so I felt vindicated by that, but anyway. So let's go back. I was at this, in, it was 1993, before some in this room were even born. I attended the annual meetings of the National Women's Studies Association. And I was there not really to participate, but to observe, because I was working on my book, Who Stole Feminism? And I was, you know, these were some of the women who had done that. And I was in luck. On that day, so these are scholars, women's studies scholars, were at a conference. But apparently there'd been big fights. And so this was, they were going to, we sang songs and held hands. It was all about unity because of the many, many struggles among our sisters in the NAACP. And the National Women's Studies Association, NAASA. So the first thing we did was break down into groups according to our grievance and healing needs. So there were a lot of groups. There were, and there were, you know, Asian women, African-American women, old women, Jewish women, disabled women, fat women. None of these groups proved stable. There were no, by the way, there were no men there to oppress us, so we did that to one another. The fat group immediately polarized into a gay and straight faction, so they had to form a third group. There was a black lesbian group. They couldn't get along because some of them had white partners. That gave them privilege. They had to separate. And new identities emerged, a group called Women with Allergies. They formed, I'm serious, they formed a little group. They issued demands. We were not supposed to wear perfume or dry clean clothes to any future NAASA events. Anyway, it was just this victimology spinning out of control. By the way, my sister and I ended up bonding with some lesbian separatists, a group. And the reason, because they smoked and we needed a cigarette. We weren't smokers, but I needed a cigarette. Anyway, the feminist scholars at that conference, they would spend the next, well, let's see, this was 25 years teaching students to see the world as they did. So they had all their grievance groups, that's the intersectional part, you break it. They had the radical theory and this, you know, of Catherine MacKinnon and Andrea Dworkin and so forth. And They've been writing articles and creating the textbooks and forming task forces, working groups. And any dissident or non-believer is just told to, well, you're considered a crank. And because very few people do it, so when people like me come forward and do it, they're very angry, and so it goes. However, the anger that I'm getting focused on me and some of my friends is unlike anything I've ever seen. It's gotten much worse. I don't know what happened. I started to notice it in around 2016. I have been going to campuses all these years to debate with you know, usually a small group of women studies majors, and you know, and sometimes it was friendly, sometimes it was tense, but it was always small. And now I get big audiences, and half of them come loaded, you know, for bear. They're furious at me, and they, the most peculiar thing happened, like at Oberlin and Georgetown, they created safe spaces where they could flee from me if I said something, because they can, as one Oberlin professor described Christina Hoff Sommers and her discursive violence, okay. The violent discourse. Discourse is not violent, right? So they're already very, very carried away. And at Oberlin, 30 young women and a therapy dog fled to a safe space. I triggered a dog, and I still feel bad about that dog. At University of Massachusetts, while I was speaking, they were screeching students, and they were wouldn't let me speak. And one young woman was screaming, you know, F you, the whole time I was talking. And I said, young lady, you know, please calm down. And she said, don't treat me like a child. And she was sort of acting like a child. But I don't want to say that this mentality has taken over the campus, but it is on almost every campus. And it's getting stronger, because now this mindset has moved to the administration. So, for example, just give you a couple of cases like at American University. So it was International Women's Day, and some prankster crossed out women and put International Nags Day. All right, it's, you know, maybe I can see people might not like it. Take it down. Who cares? Well, the AU, the American University Bias Response Team, just pounced, went into action, and there was a all points bulletin, police campus, you know, hate crime alert, and people, you know, stayed in their room until they were able to apprehend the poster, you know, and take it. I mean, what? And then I found it's just another example of there are so many at Santa Cruz. A psychology professor has come up with a microaggression app. You can have it on your iPhone, and if on campus somebody says something, you know, you can immediately report it. And I don't know if she's marketing it yet, but she was developing it. And I went on the time she had a website where people could where she listed microaggressions. Does everyone know what a microaggression is? Okay, just little insults, but they're micro, but they're still apparently very damaging, and they're done haphazardly by people who are reminding you of your inferior status. So, for example, if I call, you refer to women, you guys. That's, you know, it's not apparently insulting, but it diminishes women as members of the community, because you're using a male term. I don't know. I don't even get it, but that's an example. But there were some real they're microaggressions, and, you know, they're macro annoying, but they've taken over the campus, and there are these bias report teams that report them. But anyway, at this case, I looked at the website to see, well, what did they report? So one young woman had suffered a microaggression from a friend. She said, I told a male-identified friend. And if you know why they call, and I won't even explain it. I told a male-identified friend that I am taking a class called Women's Lives. He jokingly said, so, are you going to learn to make me a sandwich? Big mistake. Imagine your friend, all right, your friend tells you this. I mean, it's kind of funny. You go to an app and you report your friend. You have to be a little worked up to do that. Oh, here's one I liked. It's not so much about gender, but it's same sort of thing. They said, my friend asked what I was drinking for Cinco de Drinco. So it's a, you know, Cinco de Mayo joke. It offended me to think that a significant battle in Mexican history had come to be a joke. Dear offended person, it was not a significant battle. They were fighting the French, and almost no one... No, the fact, I mean, honestly, nobody in Mexico, I have relatives in Mexico, no one cares about this holiday. It was a largely invention, I think, the tequila and Corona beer distributors in the U.S. So anyway, I just think that person should calm down and have a drink. You know, I'll make them a sandwich. But anyway, how does a place like Santa Cruz, I'm just checking my time here because I have... How does a place like Santa Cruz, which was once a symbol of, I don't know, rebellion and liberation and stoners, I guess, how does it become hospitable to like an anonymous surveillance system, you know, where you turn one another in for lapses and jokes? Why safe spaces at Oberlin? This is probably, you know, the safest place on the planet for the most privileged, indulged people in human history. And they need safe spaces at Georgetown and at UMass. Our colleges and universities are supposed to be bastions of freedom, but they're becoming less free. And much of this is being done under the banner of feminism. Well, why did this happen, and how did all of this madness, in my opinion, how did it gain momentum? Well, one thing you should know is that these women are, for reasons I have yet to fathom, they're in a gender war. And as in all wars, the first casualty is truth. And they take advantage of a body of propaganda, which they have very successfully promulgated, certainly on the campus, but in the society in general. They have a set of misleading fictoids, exaggerations, sometimes outright inventions, that have taken on the aura of truth. And some have been repeated so often, they're almost beyond rational analysis. Now, a young woman, first day in college, or this could be happening in high schools too, because I've seen some of this in high school books, a young woman will learn that when she enters the workplace, she's going to be cheated out of a quarter of her salary, that she's, that 30% of American women suffer domestic violence, that one in four is sexually assaulted, raped, that you face a massive amount, and just an epidemic of harassment and demeaning mistreatment on social media, and that's only if you're not already dead from an eating disorder, anorexia, from desperate efforts to meet patriarchal standards of beauty. Now, these claims are all about real problems. One of the points I make in my book, and I continue to make, is that there are sexual violence, workplace harassment, eating disorders, these are serious things. And they need good scholarship, and we need responsible policies. Domestic violence, it's gone down, we know that, but there's too much. We need sober research. But in the hands of the academic feminists, they seem to be less interested in getting the numbers right and getting sober policies as using it as evidence to support their theory. Because remember, I told you, they have a theory that we live in this infinitely oppressive system, and as Catherine McKinnon, this rather brilliant legal scholar, but very carried away with this theory, she once said, this system is so complete and so perfect, it's almost invisible. So that's why the average woman, you ask her about it, and a lot of us didn't know we were oppressed. So if you have a theory like that, what you believe is that secretly, somewhere, there's just this, all of these crimes are going on, and now we're going to bring them to the open. And so they tell women. Now, I started a video series called The Factual Feminist. I host this internet show where I spend most of my time correcting feminist myths, mistakes, and bogus statistics. When I started the series, my my mother said, "Darling, you know, you're doing it every week. There can't, how many myths can there be?" And I told her, I can go on forever. Because what there were these mistakes, these exaggerations, these just untruths, and they never got corrected. They just got repeated. And they were repeated so often that if you came along and corrected them, you seemed insensitive to the problem. Let's take something like the wage gap. How many times have you heard that for the same work, women earn 77 cents for every dollar a man earns? Now, just think about that. If employers could pay a woman about 23% less than you would have to pay a man or she would have to pay a man, why wouldn't they just fire all the male employees and hire only women? You'd have a huge advantage over your competitor. Well, it doesn't work that way because the gap is actually just the average difference between all men working full-time and all women. And you just do the average, and it depends how you do it, but it comes out to about 23 cents. It doesn't take into account what job you do, how many hours you work per week. It doesn't take into account what did you study in college. None of that. And there are lots of factors that drive wages. Now, what happens when economists, including feminist economists, when they take all the relevant factors into consideration, what happens is the gap narrows, and according to some studies, it disappears. There, many people can still find about 5 cents they can't account for, but nobody knows if that's from discrimination or just some more subtle difference between the men and women in the workplace. Now, wage gap activists, they will say, no, even women with identical backgrounds who work, you know, the same college education, the same major, they still earn less. And I try to be open-minded. I said, okay, show me the study. And they'll refer me to something, and every time they leave out some obvious critical variable. I mean, why play this game? And it's not that women don't struggle in the workplace. They do. So why don't we start with sound research and be honest about it? It's not that employers, unscrupulous employers, are cheating women out of almost a quarter of their salary. It's partly to do with, for example, what women study in college. We know the highest paying major, I saw a recently list, is petroleum engineer. And the happens to be, I don't know, like 80% or more males that choose that major. If you study early childhood education, you may find that very rewarding. You will not make as much as a petroleum engineer. You will make a lot less. And so the feminists say, well, why should that be? What kind of a society values petroleum, you know, over children? And then I say, well, I value children over petroleum, you know, more than petroleum. But a lot of people enjoy taking care of children and have a lot of people do a good job at it. And the skill set for, you know, a petroleum engineer, it's just a little tougher and different and, you know, takes longer. Anyway, we go on and on. And I, as I said, I don't think it's over, but let's just move on. Like, we hear that we live in a patriarchal rape culture. Rape is a horrible crime, and no matter what the data say, and there is far too much sexual violence in the society, and there are predators and, you know, Harvey Weinsteins in our midst, so I still remained a feminist. Despite the fact that violence has gone down, it still exacts a terrible toll. But let's tell the truth about it. There is no serious study that I have ever seen. Maybe someone will produce one, but if you look at, for example, violence on campus, the Bureau of Justice Statistics, which sets the gold standard for research, they looked at it and they find that it's about 1 in 53. It's too much, but apparently not enough for the gender warriors. They say it's 1 in 4. And I look at the studies, and what they do is, they're agenda-driven studies. I'll do an agenda-driven study right here. Like, how many of you, when you were young, were ever kicked or hit by a brother or sister? Oh, my goodness. That's more than I... How many of you ever kicked or hit a brother or sister? Ah. All right, I'm going to write an article about a history of severe family violence in the background of students at the YAF, you know, Reagan Ranch Conference. You can do it. You redefine the terms. And so a lot of these campus studies The way they do it is they ask vaguely worded questions, usually online, so you self-select into the survey. And they ask vaguely worded questions and to a non-representative sample and then project it onto the whole society. And again, I ask, how is that going to help women who are plagued by violence? How is that, what good is this doing? It's getting in the way of solutions. But people now believe it. And if you come and say, no, that's an exaggeration, they say, oh, you're quibbling over statistics, you don't care. And so it's, a couple of weeks ago, my last factual feminist, it was a month ago, reacted to a new study by the Thomson Reuters, because now it's not only the feminist activists, it's in the mainstream. Thomson Reuters, you know, a respected news organization, the foundation of a very well-regarded news organization, did a study that claimed that worst countries in the world for women, the most dangerous, undesirable places for women, the top 10. The U.S. made the list, right? Of all the countries, we made the list. And we came in number 3 for sexual violence, in between war-torn Congo and Syria. And it was, you know, reported in CNN. It was, you know, all over. And I called up, as no reporter thought to do, apparently, I called up and asked them, how did you do this? How did we come out? What did you do to find that? Because it wasn't clear from their materials. And they just sent back a form letter saying, we asked a set of experts for their perceptions. And and then I wrote back and said, well, who were the experts? That had to be kept confidential. So it was a set of confidential experts that, I don't know. It's not a methodology. It's nothing. But it was reported as if it was serious social science. And a lot of journalists are prepared to believe that we are comparable to war-torn Congo or, you know, Iraq for women or Somalia. It's insane. But this is where we are. And by the way, there are a lot of women's studies scholars now who are incensed. There have been a series of articles this last few weeks in the Post, the Times, and in other websites, Slate and Susanna Denuta Walters is one of my favorites. She's a professor of sociology and director of Women's Gender and Sexuality at Northeastern, and she's the editor of, it used to be, I think it still is, the leading gender studies journal, Signs. So she's not a peripheral figure. She's mainstream in this field. And the name of the article is Why Can't We Hate Men? And she decides that not only can we, but we should. She talks about toxic masculinity, and she ends with these uplifting words. Men, we have every right to hate you. And now she embraces the logic of, and a lot of women, and some men who agree with them, are right now embracing this logic, which is the classic logic of bigotry, is you'll take the worst case example, you'll take someone who behaved monstrously, and then blame the group, blame their ethnic group, or blame their race, or a whole sex gets blamed for the crimes of a few. I mean, most men are not monsters. She'll say, well, the majority of crimes are committed by men, violent crimes. That's true, but the majority of men do not commit violent crimes. It's a small percentage. Let's deal with that. Let's find policies to, but not try to accuse all men of being monsters. But this is a theory that is now has pathologized masculinity. Masculinity is a disorder in need of a cure, which they apparently want to offer. And that you'd read my book, War Against Boys, to find out some of the things going on in pursuit of that end. Now, I will tell you that some men are beginning to organize, and it's not all good news because there are these men's rights activists. That, now, some of it is perfectly respectable. There's some groups that are trying to help boys in school, and there's the Men's Health Network. But there's a group called A Voice for Men, and it's run by a guy named Paul. Well, I won't even say his name because He made a video denouncing me, so I'm not going to say his name. He called me a stealth feminist, but it's not stealth. I'm the factual feminist. I don't pretend. But anyway, he is the sort of counterpart to Professor DeNudo. She hates, now she's all freaking out about men, freaking out, and he's freaking out about women. And on his website, he described women as opportunistic parasites in the lives of men. And like her, he has a list of injustices. Women, he says, exploit men financially. They subject us to ruinous divorces, alienate us, and da da da. He describes destructive personality disordered women whose evil acts are enabled by society. But instead of hating women, actually, Elam suggests people, just men, just avoid them. He endorses a movement called MGTOW, Men Going Their Own Way. And he wants men, don't get married, don't date, stay away. If possible, be celibate. But if you need sex, hire an escort. Okay. Susanna, that professor, and Paul, they're like some bitter divorcing couple. And they want to, you know, tell us what monsters the other is. I don't want to hear it. Modern life is a complicated mix of benefits and burdens. I know, I have 5 minutes. That's it. Okay. Modern life is a complicated mix of benefits and burdens for each sex. And in some ways, you know, there are ways in which, you know, men have advantage, but women have advantages as well. We're ahead of men in education, and we live longer. And men do most of the gritty, dangerous, horrible jobs. There's something like about 5,000 Americans, or 4,600 die every year, according to the Bureau, the Labor Department. And most of them men, because they do the dangerous jobs. And it's about 94% of those deaths are men. So we always hear about, you know, the men, the CEOs of the Fortune 500. That's just 500. These are like every year, 4,600 men die on the job, and let alone the numbers injured. And you can go on and on. It's a complicated mix of benefits and burdens. But here's what worries me, is that all of this that I'm talking about, this bitterness, it's spreading and it's divisive. And a wise person once said, nobody's going to win the gender war. There'll be too much fraternizing with the enemy. Now, I think that's right. There would be a lot of cavorting and socializing and crossing enemy lines. And but the important thing to know, it's a battle nobody can win, but we can all lose. And men and women need each other. We've been known to love one another. We rise and fall together. So a gender war is a war against ourselves. So my basic argument is that there was this twisted theory. It's supported by propaganda, by phony, bogus statistics. And the media has sort of gone along with it. And it's moving into other areas of American life. And it's on the move, and it's divisive. It's turning us against one another. It's not solving problems. There are problems that I care about, and any person of conscience cares about, injustice and violence. This isn't going to solve those problems. It's just going to create more havoc. Now, I can imagine, just to consider a counterposition to what I've said, I can imagine somebody saying to me, look, you're right. You know, some of these professors go overboard, and there might be some bad information out there. But workplace injustice and sexual harassment and violence, these are real problems. Maybe society just needs a radical kind of in-your-face group of people to come along and just say they're not going to take it anymore. And instead of being critical of these people, you should support them, because that's how we get change. And, you know, radicals always go too far, but that's how change is made. Well, here's what worries me about that position. It's not enough to change the world. You have to change it for the better. And if you look at social movements, Martin Luther King, Mahatma Gandhi, if you look at the gay rights movement, each of these struggles made progress by focusing on our common humanity. And these struggles made progress because they had a solid grasp of reality and how the world could be. But what happens when you have a determined social movement that has a tenuous grasp on reality? And it's not about saying what we all have in common, our shared identity, but telling you how really bad that other group is. That such crusades have a pretty bad history. They tend to breed rancor and confusion, the opposite of progress. That is what I think we're facing in our universities. It is not, they want to, you know, have the cachet of a progressive social movement, and all of you who thwart them are part of the reactionary and negative, you know, benighted force. No, I think what we're seeing is that this is reactionary. I think it's taking away a lot of the achievements of feminism by teaching women, who, young women at these colleges, where I said they're the most empowered, opportunity rich in history, to tell them to be frightened, and you know that they're constantly, you know, the world's rigged against them, when the opposite is true. So this gender war, feminism is on the move. It's graduated from Oberlin and Georgetown into Silicon Valley, and it's in the New York Times, it's in the Washington Post. They don't dominate there, but they have the they have a presence. How do you stop this contagion of hysteria? Well, I haven't managed to do it yet. I've been trying for many years. But as a former philosophy professor, I do have great faith in the power of rational discourse. And a wise person once observed that the voice of reason is small, but it's persistent. So I do think reason can prevail over madness, but only if reasonable people speak up. And today, at least on campus, the forces of unreason are better organized. Reason needs a lobby. But that's why everyone in the room here today fills me with hope. And I think that you're supporting YAF, and this organization is a critical force in keeping logic and truth and reason and sanity alive on the campus. And I, when I go to these colleges and I meet YAF members, and this, I've done this at Cal State LA and at University of Michigan last year, Suffolk, Buffalo, Brandeis, these are the greatest students in the world. They fill me with hope, and they're having a lot of fun, by the way. It's sort of, you have a good time when you have such erratic forces reigned against you. As things get crazier, I think the work of YAF becomes more critical. So I want to thank all of you here who support it, and all of the students who may, you know, end up joining when they get into college. And I would actually applaud you if I didn't think that would cause panic in the room. Thank you.
We have time for just a couple of questions. Our supporters, the adults in the room, you can raise your hand, and students, you can line up at the mic, and then we have a couple of virtual questions as well.
Hi, I have a question. I visit a state university in a very liberal state every year. And when I sit in the student union and walk by, the women, vast majority of them have full facial makeup on. The vast majority of them dress to showcase their feminine qualities. All right? And the number that I've talked to at the end of their schooling talk about finding a husband. So I wonder how much of feminism and the gender studies department, how much of that is percolated through to the general student body at all, or the students similar to the way I was in college when we used to laugh at the left-wing professors? In other words, where's the disconnect there?
Yeah, best I can tell, on most campuses, the radical, you know, students that act out and would come and protest me, they're still a minority. The majority of students are probably, I'll give you an example. I spoke at Lewis and Clark. This was a law school. I didn't expect this. And the students, there were quite a few of them that protested me just for being an equity feminist and, you know, challenging their sacred statistics. And they came to protest, and they wouldn't let me speak. They ran up on the podium, and if you just Google my name and Lewis and Clark College, you can see it. It's insane. They come up, and they have chants. They're chanting, and the wage gap is real. And this one woman had a jacket that said, "Stay woked" on the back, you know, and she wasn't. Anyway, she was leading the chants, but she couldn't remember them, so she had to look at her iPhone. And I just think, you know, like, if you're going to lead chants at a protest, you know, have the decency to memorize your chants. But anyway, after, the point is, and I do have one, I'm going on. There were a lot of students there. Liberal, most of them liberal, some conservative. The Federalist Society had invited me. And they were upset by how these students acted out. Those radical students didn't represent even the very liberal students in the college, but they're the noisiest. And they're intimidating. So when you get to school, you'll see that there are a lot of liberal students who are not carried away with this. I mean, they might believe some of the false statistics, but you can reason with them. So it's only a very small number. But they're increasingly confident. There was a time where there would be demonstrators like that, and other students would tell them, just be quiet and sit down, and they would. Now they don't. Partly because this theory, this particular version of radical feminist intersectional postmodern theory, it says that speech is violence. And so, because I'm reinforcing the dominant narrative and, you know, with holding up the matrix of oppression, so I'm contributing to everything that, so why wouldn't you shout me down and do anything you can to silence me? Because that's their worldview. But it's not the worldview of a majority. But that's why you need, you know, I encourage students to join free speech groups on campus or a group like YAF, or there's a group, Foundation for Individual Rights in Education, that's fighting for free speech, because you can still win over majorities. But the marginal, the leftist groups are more confident than ever. Next question.
So our next question is from one of our virtual attendees.
Oh, I neglected them. Hi, virtual attendees. Where are they?
This is from Andrew in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And he said, how do we as male students defend someone like Brett Kavanaugh as innocent until proven guilty in an age when the Me Too movement instantly calls him a gang rapist and all men defending him a terrible person?
Oh, well, I don't even get me started on the Kavanaugh thing, because that I was seeing it differently from it. Most people were watching it, and I was seeing exactly what I'd been seeing going on the campus. A lot of young men are brought up and with baseless charges in kangaroo courts, and rumors taken as true. And I mean, I'm not saying that I thought she was lying. I just thought we didn't have enough evidence, and this should never have even happened. We should not have had this this complete circus. Yes, for men right now, it's very hard to talk about it. I'm even afraid to talk about it in my own family, because people are like, we get in fights if you say the wrong thing, and it's dividing friends. So wait until the Kavanaugh thing, wait until it cools down a little bit, and people maybe get, I hope, a little more objective, and wait. That's my advice. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Davis from the Classical Academy, and before I ask this question, did you not address the same issue in a PragerU video?
I've done a few of them. I've done on the war against boys.
Yeah,
and I've done two on the wage gap.
Okay.
And it can't be corrected anymore. It's just, we just have to accept it because it's been repeated so many times. It's just, there it is.
All right. So my question is, what on earth specifically, aside from leftism itself, caused people such as feminist universities and like-minded individuals to think so irrationally?
Well, I'm a philosopher, not a psychiatrist, but I will try to answer. I'm going to answer this way. I think with feminism, it's gotten a lot farther than other groups. Lots of groups would like to have a presence on campus and teach their, their way of thinking. But the feminists, it's a very political group that on campus that has flourished there because people are afraid to say no, and I've seen this happen. People are like, okay, let them do that. They want to, okay, let them hire what they want. The departments have gotten crazier and crazier because a lot of male deans, maybe they thought, oh, I guess this is progress. I'm hiring, this expert in, masculinity studies who thinks, that all men are pathological. But maybe he thinks it's progressive, so he doesn't say no. And then they do their scholarship. They write their books. Who reviews them? Well, they have their own journals. And they, just love each other's work. And anybody that criticizes doesn't understand. So I don't know, except maybe in some ethnic studies or, in black studies, maybe Latino studies, you may have something similar going on but I know this is going on in gender studies. There's no quality control. There's no real peer review. And people are afraid to say anything. And by the time they realize right now how crazy it's become, they have a lot of power. And they have allies throughout the administration. So that's how it happened. Now, why do they want to do it? Yeah, it's something. I read a lovely book by a French philosopher, Pascal Bruckner. The left has always, it's a very Western thing, for elites and children of the wealthy to hate their own society. It's been going on since the 18th century, and there's a longing for perfection, and impatience. With human fallibility, and so there are people who will have a tendency to make the perfect the enemy of the good. So even though we have a pretty good society for women, it's not perfect, and so they exaggerate it and trample it. And I think for some people, there's just a fascination with hating their own society, just exaggerating its faults, and forming a little group and feeling righteous and feeling no one else understands. And the last thing I'll say is I actually have been researching this partly because there aren't that many women scholars like me, and sometimes I think, that's not really a good sign. If you were right, wouldn't there be like a lot more on your side? Maybe you really have internalized the logic of the patriarchy, and I have some female colleagues that keep me sane in it. But still, I thought, no, they bought into a conspiracy theory. So I researched, what kind of people go in for conspiracy theories? And at first, there were theories that said, well, less intelligent, less educated. But then they said, however, there's one exception. There are people who are very intelligent and very well educated. But if they don't care that much about being rational and consistent, watch out. Because they can really get very deeply and at a very high level. And I think that's what happened. Catherine McKinnon is brilliant, but she was a conspiracy theorist about this patriarchy doesn't exist. But she had the intelligence. She didn't care. I mean, being logical and rational and evidence-based, she wrote those off as male values. And so she was able to create a very complex world, and now students that don't know this, they go in and they're presented with her facts and her theories, and you go right in, and it can be exhilarating, I guess, for a while. So that's the best I can do. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I'm dying to ask you a question. I always joke and say I don't need to be a feminist because I was raised at an all-girls school.
Yeah.
Okay, no boys, girls, 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 no hassling, no violence, no anything else. And on top of that, your best student in science is going to be a girl, the best student in math is going to be a girl. And whenever I bring this up to my feminist friends, they have such an antipathy and such an aversion to all-girls schools. And I'm thinking, this will solve all your problem. What is your reaction and what?
Well, it was a few years ago, I wrote an article in The Atlantic about it. And exactly what you're saying is it does solve a lot of problems. And they're very good for boys, too, by the way. But you would think, to strengthen young women in math and science and all that, there's evidence that it's effective. Well, the feminists are against it because the fashion is we have to destabilize the notion of gender, you know, of male and female. And so if you have boys and girls school, you're admitting that there are boys and girls when we just, you know, it's all gender fluid. And so if you do that, you're reinforcing the status quo. So the ACLU and some other feminist groups are actually suing their efforts to establish some all-girls classes in the public high schools and all-boys classes because girls do need extra help with math and science and boys need a lot of help with reading and writing. And so they established these. And the ACLU sued, and this group of professors called it gender apartheid, you know. So they use this, you know, completely ludicrous moral language, you know, to go after something innocent because they're burdened with a deranged ideology. So that's where we are. And that's an example of how we can't even solve a real problem, something that could be very helpful to kids, because their ideology gets in the way of solutions. Yeah. Thank you very much.